Hello, I'm Christian Hafner, and I want to talk to you about our work on the design space of plane elastic curves, done with my supervisor Bernd Bickel at IST Austria. Let me start with some motivation on why to study elastic curves. Curved elements, often in the form of curved timber, are a visually striking and impressive part of contemporary design and architecture. However, their use is somewhat limited by the complex and expensive process required to produce these elements. Conventionally, timber is curved in advance, by softening the fibers with steam, bending individual elements into shape with custom-made molds and clamps so the deformation becomes plastic ahead of lamination. The method that I want to talk about is an alternative to steam bending, known as active bending. The promise of this method is to save costs both in fabrication and transportation by using flat beams directly for construction, without any kind of pre-bending. And here, elements attain their curved shape simply by installing them in a support structure, so they remain under stress even after construction has finished. And what we can do to control the geometry of the curved shape is to adapt the stiffness profile of every element. So let me give you an idea of how we can control the stiffness profile. One way is to taper the width of the beam, because having wider and narrower sections selectively changes the stiffness, which has an influence on the final shape. And we can achieve the same effect by perforating the beam, which selectively weakens the material, or by layering tapered beams to widen the stiffness gamut further. And in the video you can see how the same curved shape is achieved with these three techniques. Now, one of the reasons why active bending is not as frequently used as steam bending is that there are several challenges related to the design of active bending structures. First of all, it's not immediately clear how large the design space even is, so which kinds of shapes can be achieved using active bending? This is a question about the fundamental physical limits of the method, and it's the first one that I want to answer. There's one famous classical work related to this question, which treats the case of constant stiffness. And it was Euler who first characterized all curves that can result from bending an initially flat beam. But what we're interested in is a generalization to the case of arbitrary stiffness profiles. More recently, there's also been work on the design of beams with a curved rest shape, where the goal is to find this curved rest shape if we know what the deformed shape looks like when the beam is suspended under gravity. In contrast to these works, we're interested in flat rest shapes, because this is what makes active bending economically attractive. Now let's make our setup more concrete and introduce some notation. We start with a straight flat beam of length L with arc length parameter S and the stiffness at every point given by some function k of S. Then we apply boundary conditions that constrain the position and tangents at both boundary points of the beam. We're only looking at in-plane bending, so we can characterize the deformed shape as an arc length parameterized plane curve gamma. We also need a symbol for the turning angle, call it alpha, which is the angle between the horizontal and the curved tangent gamma prime. Finally, we also need the sine curvature of the curve, kappa, which is given by the first derivative of the turning angle. And the question we want to answer is the following. If we are allowed to arbitrarily choose a stiffness function, which has to be everywhere positive, which deformed shapes can we generate? Now let's see how to arrive at the deformed shape mathematically. Elastica theory tells us that equilibrium curves are stationary points of an energy, which is given by the integral over the stiffness scale square of the curvature. We also need to supply boundary conditions, and here we're choosing to fix both the tangents and positions of both boundary points, because this maximizes the design space. One can now show with a few steps of computation that stationary points of the energy are characterized by the so-called moment equilibrium equation. This equation says that the internal moment, given by the product of stiffness and curvature, equals the moment generated by the boundary conditions, which is the expression on the right-hand side. And this equation holds for some choice of the constants A and B. We will give a geometric interpretation to these two constants shortly. What we're interested in is figuring out for which curves we can find a stiffness function as well as values for A and B that satisfy this equation, because this will tell us which curves can be achieved in active bending. And now the main result that we prove in the paper is the following theorem. For a given curve gamma, we can satisfy the moment equilibrium equation with appropriate choices for k, a, and b, if and only if there exists a line that intersects gamma exactly in its inflection points. Plus, there are also a few technical conditions, but for these I refer you to the paper. Now let's see why this theorem holds. Here we have our moment equilibrium equation again and an example curve. So let's try to figure out whether we can determine the stiffness function and values for a and b in such a way that the equation is satisfied. First, let's look at the left-hand side of the equation. We know that no matter how we choose the stiffness, it has to be positive everywhere. And this tells us that the left-hand side will always have the same sign as the curvature. And to reflect this, I've drawn the positively curved and negatively curved parts of the curve in different colors. Next, let's look at the right-hand side. We can see that this expression has the form of an affine map of the plane, with coefficients a and b. And this map is evaluated at the curve points gamma of s. And affine maps have the property that they always split the plane into a positive and negative half space. And what we could do for this example curve is to pick a and b in such a way that these two half spaces perfectly agree with the positively curved and negatively curved parts of the curve. And the result is that the line which separates these two half spaces intersects exactly the inflections of the curve, because these are the points where the sign of the curvature changes. And this choice of a and b, which defines this line, guarantees that the signs of the two sides of the equation agree at every point. We still have to make sure that the magnitudes of the two sides equal as well, but since we can choose k freely for every s, this is easy to do. So in summary, we have seen that we can satisfy this equation by making appropriate choices for a, b, and k, if and only if the positively and negatively curved parts of the curve are linearly separable, which is the same as saying that we can draw a line that intersects the curve exactly in its inflections. So let's try and put this theorem to use by deciding for a few example curves which ones can be achieved by active bending. We start by coloring the curves according to the curvature sign, and then let's look at the top row of examples first. Here we can always draw a line that intersects the curve exactly in its inflection points. The first curve has no inflections, so we have to draw the line in a way that does not intersect the curve at all. Let's compare this to the examples in the bottom row. Here we can verify that we cannot draw lines that intersect the curves exactly in their inflections. For example, even though the first curve only has a single inflection point, whatever line we draw through it will also intersect the curve in non-inflectional points, which is according to our theorem not allowed. This tells us that the curves at the top can be achieved as equilibrium curves in active bending, but for the curves at the bottom, this is physically impossible. Now this geometric characterization has given us a new skill. We can now look at any curve design, for example an architectural one, and immediately tell by inspection alone whether there is hope to realize it by plain active bending. And the next natural question is, how can we physically realize a design like this? In other words, how do we determine the stiffness profile that realizes a given curve? To figure this out, let's look at the moment equilibrium equation again. What we can see is that as soon as we have chosen values for a and b, this already defines the stiffness function k uniquely. For curves that have at least two inflections, this makes the situation very simple. The constants a and b define a line which, according to our theorem, needs to intersect all inflection points. But there is only one such line. And this tells us that the choice for a and b is unique, at least up to positive free scaling, so k is unique as well. This means that there is only a single stiffness profile that realizes this curve. But for curves that have either 0 or 1 inflections, the situation is more interesting, because the stiffness profile is not unique. And this raises the natural question of whether there is a best choice for the stiffness profile. Now we would argue that the objective that best describes the qualities we're looking for in a physical beam is the max to min stiffness ratio of the beam. What we get by minimizing this objective is the beam that is maximally uniform among all possible choices for the given target curve. This has the effect of promoting structural integrity because it avoids narrow sections in the stiffness profile, and it also makes fabrication easier because it's difficult to achieve a very high range of stiffnesses within a single element. Let's take a look at how to solve this optimization problem. It turns out that even though the objective is a fraction of two linear functions, the problem itself is actually linear. And the reason for this is that we can show that the objective function is invariant under rescaling. And this allows us to introduce a normalization constraint without actually changing the problem. And the most convenient choice here is to say that the minimum of k equals 1. And then what we're left with is a linear objective function with an affine constraint, which gives us a linear problem overall. The last step in solving this problem is to sample our target curve and formulate a linear program. And it turns out that a very small linear program with only 4 variables suffices. So we have variables a and b for the coefficients of the affine map, and a variable r that stands in for the maximal stiffness. We want to minimize this maximal stiffness, and we're sandwiching the stiffness values at every curve sample between the minimum value of 1 and the maximum stiffness given by r. And finally, the equality constraints make sure that the line described by the variables a and b intersects the target curve in its inflections. Solving this problem takes under 1 millisecond for any of the curves that we've tried it on, so the computational overhead for computing optimal stiffness profiles is minimal. Now let's look at a few examples. Here we have two target curves and the corresponding stiffness profiles that have been computed by the linear program. If we input these stiffness profiles into a forward simulator and apply boundary conditions, we exactly recover the target curves at equilibrium. Next, let's look at what would happen if we didn't choose A and B optimally, but in some other way. Here we have an elliptical arc as the target curve, and the optimal values for A and B, which define the line shown here, yield a stiffness ratio of 2.0. Now, if we were to choose A and B differently, by moving this line around, we can see that this leads to an increase of the stiffness ratio of up to a factor of 10, and it induces this narrow section in the stiffness profile, which makes it unusable in practice. So we can see that choosing A and B optimally with our linear program really makes a big difference in quality, even for a simple example such as this. We can use the linear program to design simple structures in active bending, such as this one. This model is about 1 meter long and is composed of 31 arcs. Each flat element is cut from cardboard and then curved by inserting it into a 3D printed base that has indentations to enforce the boundary conditions. One detail that I've left out is that we can actually extend our linear program to also take into account the weight of the beam under gravity, which we have done for this model. This adds a few lines to the linear program, but only increases the computation time marginally. For details about this, I will refer you to the paper. At this point, we know exactly what curved designs are physically viable with active bending and how to realize them. But one issue that remains is that not every design which can be realized in theory is very practical for fabrication. So this leads to the question, how can we improve such designs? First of all, what are the reasons that make a design impractical? The one we found to be most common is that for many target curves, even the optimal stiffness ratio is too high for practical applications. Here I'm showing a few curves from one of our examples, and even though they look reasonably smooth, all of them have very narrow stiffness profiles that make them unusable for fabrication. What we would want to do in this case is to slightly modify the target curves in a way that doesn't impact them too much visually, but that allows for a stiffness profile with a much lower stiffness ratio. To do this, we need a representation of the target curve that allows us to modify it, and we choose a standard B-spline curve with control points that define the curve geometry. Looking at our moment equilibrium equation again tells us that the stiffness function is affected both by the control points, because they define gamma and kappa, as well as by A and B, which we find by solving our linear program. Our objective is to decrease the max to min stiffness ratio r, which can be done by simultaneously optimizing the control points as well as A and B. But because r is a nonlinear function, a gradient-based approach is the natural choice here. One issue with this is that solving a linear program is not a differentiable operation. However, we can get around this problem as follows. We perform gradient descent on the control points, but we keep the values for A and B constant during this step, so the linear program does not interfere with the computation of a gradient. Then in a second step, we resolve the linear program to attain optimal values for A and B again. In this step, the control points are kept constant, and we simply alternate these two steps. Next, let's see how this algorithm performs on a practical example. Here we start with an ERP surface and cover the surface in a set of plane section curves. The goal is to turn each of these section curves into elastic strips that cover and approximate the entire surface. If we take one of these section curves and compute the stiffness profile with the linear program, we will see that it has this extremely narrow section that makes it unusable in practice. But we can run our algorithm and track how it decreases the objective value and how it modifies the target curve and the stiffness profile in the process. So the objective value drops quite rapidly, and if we look at the stiffness profile, we can see that the narrow section disappears as the algorithm progresses. The target curve is modified in the process, but the overall deformed shape is preserved. The total runtime of this example is about 1 second. And after we optimize the other plane section curves on the surface, this is the result that we end up with. To make the physical model, we used layering here, so each of these elastic strips is made by gluing two cardboard strips, one on the inside and one on the outside. The outer layer is used to control the appearance of the strip, and the inner layer is used to match the desired stiffness profile. We applied the same algorithm to make several physical models, for example this one of a horse, which was based on an existing 3D mesh. Here we used layering again to control both the stiffness of every strip and also minimize the gaps between adjacent strips to achieve maximal coverage. And this model shows an architectural shell, which we have approximated with perforated elastic strips to achieve a stylized look. And even though every strip is only singly curved, the model still evokes the illusion of double curvature. And finally, this is our largest physical model, a ceiling lamp with a diameter of about 1 meter. The base material is plywood, and at this scale it would have been very expensive to make molds for every single strip or to 3D print the entire model. So active bending is the most economic option to achieve curvature here. The last topic that I want to briefly touch on is the second reason of why we might want to improve the target shape, and that's the problem of instability. So it may happen that our target curve is an unstable equilibrium. And what this means is that any small physical perturbation will make the curve snap out of its target shape and into a different stable configuration. And what we would want to do in this case is, first, to detect unstable target curves, and then to stabilize them by modifying the control points. So how do we detect unstable equilibria? The most common method is the eigenvalue test, for which we need to compute the minimal eigenvalue of a matrix and check whether it is negative. But our particular choice of boundary conditions adds linear constraints to this test, and currently numerical packages don't support sparsity-preserving algorithms for this type of problem, which makes it slow, especially if we want to solve many of these problems in an iterative setting. This is why we use a different test, originally devised by Jacobi. Its outcome is completely equivalent to that of the eigenvalue test, but surprisingly, it can be performed just by integrating a few linear initial value problems, which makes it very fast. Every step of this test is also differentiable, which allows us to take a gradient-based approach again to directly optimize the stability of a curve. And I'm skipping a lot of details here, but I will say that the optimization is ultimately enabled by the geometric characterization theorem that we discussed in the beginning of the talk. This theorem told us that active bending curves have collinear inflection points, and enforcing this geometric constraint is really central for making the algorithm work. Let's see how this optimization performs in practice, starting with an unstable target curve that has three inflections. I'm going to show you the animation twice, and let's look at how the stiffness profile at the bottom changes first. We can see that the algorithm starts bulging out specific parts, and this makes the curve stiffer around the inflection points. Let me play it again, and this time let's look at the target curve. The change is subtle, but we can see that the sections around the inflection points are slightly straightened out. Let's also compare physical models of the stabilized and initial curves. The stabilized solution on the left is very robust to physical perturbation and always snaps back into the target shape. Meanwhile, the initial curve is unstable and always snaps either up or down into a different equilibrium state, and it cannot keep its shape in the target state. Before I conclude, let me give you a quick recap. We saw that it is possible to geometrically characterize all plane curves that can be achieved with active bending. The deciding factor is the existence of a line that intersects the curve exactly in its inflections. Then we looked at how to compute stiffness profiles for curves in this design space, and we devised a linear program that does this within about 1 millisecond. Finally, we improved curve designs in order to make them more easily fabricable or to regain their stability. And with this, I'd like to thank you very much for your attention.